Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, still here in the Philippines for a few more days, trying to get packed up, get out of here, take care of things, you know. You ever moved? I've been moving lots of times, and every time, there's no problem, because I'm doing it for the Lord, for the Lord's glory. It's all about Him, and when we're doing something for the glory of God, hey, it's all right, because we know He's got it all in His hand. It's all part of the Master's plan, for the Lord Himself has set all these things in motion from the foundation of the world. Brothers and sisters, I was just led by the Lord. I wasn't planning on making another video. I made a few the other day, and then I was going to load them once a day while I was in the process of traveling. But the Lord just led me tonight to get on here just to talk to you a little bit. And it just came into my spirit from John chapter 6, where the Lord talks about that He's the bread of life. And the Lord said that, you know, your fathers ate manna in the wilderness, and they are dead. You know, they ate the bread, and they later died. But this bread is a type of bread that comes down from heaven, that if you eat it, you will never taste death. And the people were like, what are you talking about? And Jesus said, because my body is flesh indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. They were all tore up. All the people left. Lots of people turned back and didn't follow Him. They said, this is a hard saying that He's saying. You know, and then Jesus asked His 12 disciples, you know, will you also leave me? And Peter said, no, where else would we go for the words of life? You know, because we know that, you know, you are the Son of God. So, there are hard times, brothers and sisters. That's why I'm trying to tell you. The most, you know, here's the secret. You know, I don't want to say anything. I'm just using this as an example. Joel Osteen. He has the biggest church in America. Why is that? Why does Joel Osteen have the biggest church in America? Because he's given the grinning happy time message. People want to hear the happy time message, but they don't want to hear the whole counsel of God. They don't want to hear the whole counsel of God. They don't want to hear a Jeremiah message. Jeremiah was known as the weeping prophet. Jeremiah, you know, prophesied the doom and gloom that destruction was coming to Jerusalem. Nobody wants to hear that. Everybody wants to hear, let the good times roll. Everybody wants to hear, you know, prosperity is here and all those things. And as it tells us in the Bible, I made another short video that I will load tomorrow. Or maybe I'll load it before I load this one. I'm not sure. It's up to the Lord. But and I really did a rebuke for pastors, lukewarm pastors. And the messages that I have are really for the Laodicean church. And then, of course, there's no need to preach into the choir. There's lots of you guys who watch this video, hey, that, you know, it reminds you and strengthens you and exhorts you. But those who are backsliders, they're not exhorted. That's a clue to you. If you're hearing a video of a strong preaching, not teaching, not grinning, not prosperity showmanship, but a real preaching, and you get mad, even though you know it, you say, well, you know, I know it's in the Bible, but you're still mad about it. That's a clue that you're in the wrong and you need to repent. If you hear the preaching and it gets you glad, you're exhorted, then you say, hey, you know, hey, I'm exhorted in the fact that, hey, I'm lined up with the Word of God at this point. I'm lined up with the Word of God. So we all have those points that we need to be our toes stepped on, that we need to be shaken awake. We need to get slapped around a little bit by the Word of God and be awakened, that we might repent. Rein in that vain imagination in different areas that we all have. But if you are only hearing things that tickle your ears, you will never improve. The problem in the modern day Western world is everybody's a winner. There's no competition. Everybody's a winner. When the Bible says we run a race, that you have to win the race, it doesn't say, oh, universally everybody wins. No, you have to run the race with patience. Paul even tells us only the winner receives the prize. People want to be coddled. They want to be babied. They want to hear what they want to hear. If you would go to any sports team and listen to the coach, and the coach is yelling at the players, do you think the coach hates the players? No, the coach wants the players to do their best. He wants to maximize their talent, maximize their effort, maximize their motivation. That's what he's trying to do. He's not trying to destroy his players. He's trying to break off, break them down, as they say, and then build them up. He's trying to break down those things that's in their skills that's not right. So the same thing is true with preaching. That's why, thank the Lord, I only have a few. But the people who complain, they're complaining against the Word of God. Now, there's a difference if you say, hey, here's a false doctrine. You're teaching that people need to stand on their head to be saved. That's not biblical. Okay, that's true. If someone said that, yeah, that's false doctrine. People do not want to hear those things that they don't want to repent of. It makes them angry. As an example, one big movement in the American church today is, and even in, as a sister had asked me a question about someone else, she asked my advice about how to deal with a young brother she was trying to help out, dealing with a church that has a female pastor who is a lesbian. And this is accepted as normal. So when you get on here in a video, I made a video the other day about evolution and I mentioned something about homosexuality. It is a sin. It is still a sin. It's been a sin since the beginning of time and it is still a sin. There are people who, this is what people want to take away, what's sin and what's not sin. It's not that people don't always sin. There's always been sinners. But part of this end times Laodicean lukewarm church is they want to stop using the word sin. They want to stop saying that things are a sin. They want to make everything okay. The only sin they recognize is intolerance, which is translated to be when you say, hey, this is a sin. As an example, we're talking about homosexuality, sodomy, doing drugs, being a drunkard. Getting drunk is a sin. The Bible says a little wine is good for the stomach. But it says do not be filled with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. The Bible tells us that no drunkard will enter the kingdom of heaven. There's no drunkard entering the kingdom of heaven. So it's a sin. No, all liars have their place in the lake of fire. So lying is a sin. You don't even have to. All those different things are still sin. They're still sin. They are still sin. So if the messages that preachers are giving, even though it's part of the gospel, and they keep saying, Jesus loves you, people walking down the road with a sign, Jesus loves you, Jesus loves you, Jesus loves you, the Bible says that we are enemies of God. We are enemies of God until we get saved. We are at enmity with God. We are at war and rebellion against God until we humble ourselves and repent and become born again. That is the gospel. The gospel is God's not joking, hell's still smoking. And I've been meaning to make a video with that title, which I will by the grace of God, about hell. Sin is still sin. We all sin. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You know, that's the old Romans road, you know, for salvation. Romans 3:23, Romans 6:23, all of those 6:36, I think it is, and Romans 10:9-10. All those Bible verses that's known as the Romans road, you know, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. All those Bible verses, we know that. But the difference is of a Christian is that we know that it's a sin. We recognize by the power of the Holy Spirit working in us and the Word of God in front of our face what is sin and what is not sin. What is the fruit of the flesh and what is the fruit of the Spirit? Galatians chapter 5. We know what those things are. And you should know what those things are. Go look at Galatians chapter 5. Read the fruit of the Spirit and the fruit of the flesh. So you know if you're doing something, it's by a fruit of the Spirit of God or a fruit of your flesh. Sin. Sin nature. So that's what I wanted to talk to you guys about today, brothers and sisters. About the Lord Jesus Christ. After Jesus said that my body is bread indeed, my blood is drink indeed, the people said it's a hard saying and they stopped following him. And they walked away, just like Jesus tells the parable of the sower. I've been meaning to make a video about that. The Lord's been talking to me about it. It's the same thing I'm talking about here. I mentioned it the other day in a video, how some seed fell on the rocky ground and it started sprouting up. For all you once saved, always saved people, go read the parable of the sower and try to jibe that with once saved, always saved. Jesus said that seed that fell on the rocky ground, it started to spring up, but then it didn't have any roots. because it wasn't good soil. So when there's no rain, it's a dry, hard season, boom, it dies. It dies. It's no longer anymore a plant. It's gone. That seed that was sown, the word of God, is gone out of the heart of those who were in the gospel for a season, in Christ for a season, and then when hard times came, they walked away. Just like all those people in John chapter 6 who were following the Lord and they heard the hard sayings, they didn't want to hear it. They walked away. Now I'm going to tell you, brothers and sisters, all the churches I started, I've been involved in starting five churches. And every one of them, as long as you're preaching some ear-tickling stuff, the people love it. But when you come in with a message, even though lots of people who are sincere and want to repent and want to walk with the Lord, hey, they get glad. But there's always one or two of those tares. They're really tares. They're agitators. They, especially when you're dealing with like me, like I say, when I was dealing with all Filipinos, I'm the only American there. I'm the only Caucasian there. They're all Filipinos. So it's easy for a crowd to turn against you when you're the only minority. People that are minorities who watch this, lived as a minority anywhere in the world, you know what I'm talking about. The crowd will be amused by you and entertained and be mesmerized by you because you're unique and different than anything they know. But the crowd can also very easily turn on you. Now, I've experienced that many times. But it's because when you start preaching the hard truth, as I said, if, you know, the performance of the world, like Joel Osteen, oh, he's a great preacher because he has the biggest church in the United States. That would be the same measure that people use. What do they call it? Pragmatism. That's another one of these, failure philosophies of the world. Pragmatism. Well, whatever works. That's what that means. Be pragmatic. Whatever works. To grow your own kingdom. To grow to your denomination. To be popular. To have everybody love you. That's what is offered in most churches, unfortunately. That's why they're a little Laodicean church. You know, John Wesley, as I've mentioned many times before, even though, as we know, the United Methodist Church today is not a firebrand denomination. By no means anywhere near what it was when it started. But John Wesley wrote in his diaries, his journals, when he went to churches, he went into a church with like 400 people, which is huge in the 1700s. A 400-member church like in Philadelphia, Baltimore. When he left, there was only 12 people left. And he said, hey, we had a great two-week revival. The real Christians are left. There's about 12 of them. And all those tares, by the Spirit of God and God's holiness and righteous, holy preaching, the Lord removed all those tares out of the church. And now they have a foundational group to work with to stop building man's kingdom and build the Lord's kingdom. Now that is what God wants. And that's the only way that America or the Western world, the world, has another chance of a new season to delay the tribulation period, to delay the return of the Lord, is by fire and brimstone holiness preaching of what is sin. Revival is not just all about signs and wonders, and I'm a signs and wonders person. As of you guys have been watching my videos, and here in the Philippines, I used to do that all the time. When I was new in the ministry, I was into it. People being healed and all that. And I've seen hundreds or really thousands of people over the years healed by prayers. I made a video of the sister of one of the people I prayed for who's still healed today. A young man is about 18 years old. I prayed with in 2006. Tons of them. But Jesus said, listen to me. Jesus said, if your right eye offends you, pluck it out. It's better to enter heaven with one good eye than enter hell fire with two good eyes. You see what I'm saying? What good does it do for God to physically heal you when your spirit is rotten? Rotten, stinking to the core. What difference does it make about how good you can see in the natural when you can't see in the spiritual? What good does it do if you can't hear in the spiritual to be able to hear perfectly well in the natural? What difference does it make? Stop thinking in the carnal, lukewarm, Laodicean mind that the devil has tried to put a blinders and a web of deceit and lies around the body of Christ. Come up out of that darkness. Like Lazarus, come forth, come out of that dead religion. Wake up. Wake up. By the Spirit of God, I speak right now in the name of Jesus Christ. May the Spirit of God resurrect your spirit. May the Lord have mercy on you and give you a new chance a new opportunity, a new day of grace. And right now, the Lord is just speaking to me while I'm saying it. That is the message from the Lord that the Lord would give me for my American revival tour. By the grace of God, well, God will open the doors for me to get into these churches and tell them this is a new day of grace. A new day of grace to the church. God moves in seasons, brothers and sisters. Those old dead doctrinal denominations that I came out of when I was my family, they'll say, well, yeah, we're in the church age, we're in the age of grace. They don't have an ear to hear. God does things in seasons. Brothers and sisters, there are seasons in the move of God. God does different kinds of moves in different countries, in different ways. Of course, it's the same gospel. Of course, we have grace. But God can pour out a new grace. When I say a new grace, I mean a new window of opportunity where God moves. It's so, brothers and sisters, it's so frustrating with so many people that are so cardinal-minded. They can't grasp what I'm saying. I'm talking about a new move of God. What we call revival. That's really revival. Revival is not a series of meetings. Revival is not the church is going to have a guest speaker and let's bring all of our unsaved friends and let them get evangelized. That is not revival. That's evangelism. Revival is when God revives that which was one time vived. You have to be vived before you can be revived. You have to have been a Christian, then went to sleep, become lukewarm, fall away before you can be revived. Revival is for the church. The revival is a new spirit of, you know, a new release, a new wave of grace and mercy upon God's already his people. If my people, who are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, not the world's wicked ways, their wicked ways, and seek my face, I would hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. 2 Chronicles 7:14, the best explanation prayer from King Solomon of what is the prayer of revival. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves. You know, I went to a Baptist church. I have several relatives that are Baptist preachers. I went to one of my relatives' church and I preached a revival. And for a whole week, I couldn't get past the word humble. I tried to preach every part of that Bible verse to that church. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves. So I started out with humble. First day, I read the verse, and then I started saying, humble yourself. What does that mean? I couldn't get off of that one word for the whole week. Those old, hard shell, hardcore religious Pharisees could never get past the word humble. Because my Bible says God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. And the story that I've told several times that Jesus told, that I told to this church every night for a week, people that's supposed to have been Christians for 40 years, they couldn't get it into their spirit. They couldn't get it through their hard head and their hard heart. Where Jesus said the Pharisee went into the temple at the same time the tax collector went in there. And the Pharisee looked up and said, thank you, Lord, I'm not like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I tithe. You know, I do all this. I do all that. And then the tax collector, Jesus said, the tax collector wouldn't even look up to heaven. He smote himself in the chest and said, Lord, forgive me, I'm a sinner. And Jesus said, that man, the tax collector, went down to his house justified with God that day, but not the Pharisee. Now that is a religious spirit that I'm talking about, just exactly like that. Just exactly like that. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. So I'm telling you that this grace of God that he would release would bring humility to God's people. That's the theme in this other video I made, a short video. I'll load these two the same day. The other video I made, all of these are videos that are charges, a charge to the lukewarm church. So I charge you by the grace of God, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. He will give you strength. Humble yourself. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. There's a new grace for those who humble themselves, a time of renewal, a time of restoration, a time of preparation, a time of getting ready to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air, to become the bride of Christ, to be a part of the church of the firstborn, which is the bride of Christ in heaven at Mount Zion. Hebrews chapter 12, brothers and sisters, God has sent me in my life, in my ministry, to prepare, to help prepare His bride. Of course, I'm not saying that only people that listen to me are in the bride. So I always, it's sad that you have to throw a disclaimer for all the wicked people out there in the world. All of this wicked children of the devil that's on the internet and things like that. They love to try to, you know, twist preachers' words. I'm talking about the bride of Christ, which includes all the people in the world who are truly Christians. And my part is one of God's under-shepherds is solely to focus on preparing the bride to meet the Lord in the air. Now, brothers and sisters, I challenge you, if you want to watch my videos and listen to what I'm saying, that's the message. That's the message. Prepare yourself against the third day. Get ready. Prepare yourself. Look up, pray up, pack up, because we're going up. The Lord Jesus Christ Himself is about to descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet them in the air. Caught up, harpozo in the Greek, in the Latin, it's rapturo, where we get the word rapture. There's a regular basis I get someone who says the word rapture is not in the Bible. I still keep hearing that. It's really sad that people are so don't even have any idea what they're talking about. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to go ahead and cut this video off. I've been doing a little bit of preaching. But what I'm trying to say is I'm just being led by the Spirit. The theme of this message is hard sayings come from the Lord. The full counsel of God. You have to have the whole counsel of God. You need to have balance in what you hear. That's what I'm trying to tell you. And that's what I bring to the table from the Lord Jesus Christ in my ministry, to bring balance. There's tons of people preaching Jesus loves you. And of course I say that too, by the Spirit of God. But Jesus also is the judge. His eyes are like fire in the book of Revelation. It says His eyes are like flames of fire. He's also wielding that sharp two-edged sword, the Word of God. The Lord is a God of justice. The Lord Jesus Christ is angry with sin. Read your Bible. Read the book of Revelation, the letters He wrote. He's angry with sin. He promises judgment and punishment and rewards. People keep talking rewards and not talking punishment. They're not talking repentance. They're not talking sin. We don't need a Savior if we don't have sin. If I'm not lost and without hope in this world and an enemy of God, I don't need a Savior. What do I need a Savior for? That's the problem with the modern gospel. They're talking about Jesus can save you. Save me from what? Why do I need to be saved? You got to tell people that they're lost and they're going down in a they're in a plane that's crashing before they can accept the fact that, hey, here's a parachute. They don't need a parachute until you tell them, hey, the plane is going down. They don't need a life vest unless you say, hey, the boat is sinking. This is the Titanic. If the boat's not sinking, they're not worried about a life vest. The full gospel is the boat is sinking, the house is on fire, the plane's going down, and you need somebody to save you. Can you raise your hand if you understand what I'm saying? It's just that simple. Everybody's on here saying, "Oh, I'm the captain of the airplane. Here's a parachute for you." Okay, what's the context of why I need a parachute? Tell me why. Do I just need to assume that maybe I might need it? Oh, it's great. I feel more secure that I got a parachute. No, the plane's going to crash in 5 minutes. Here's a parachute. Would you like one? I got to go, brothers and sisters. I keep going with it. You know, I love you guys. And it's just so funny how some people, when I'm preaching, you know, they're because men have been emasculated so much by Satan's plan for the ages, like I wrote about in the book. Men have been emasculated and detesticled by this, Jezebel spirit in the world, and particularly in America. All this Jezebelization of our culture by the devil, Baphomet, the, you know, androgynous, you know, metrosexual image of Satan, the Baphomet, like Lady Gaga and all those kind of people. Like the one that just won the Eurovision thing. It's like some kind of a drag queen with a beard, but yet looks like a woman. That's straight Baphomet. That's the end time spirit of this gender bender stuff. You know, that spirit has got men so weak and wimpy and limp-wristed that when someone really speaks, people get nervous and get upset. He's angry. No, you're just not used to being around, you know, the normal way that a man should act. So in the modern day culture, because of technology, people have become weak and wimpy and limp-wristed and effeminate. So when a man really acts like a man, some people are frightened by that. That's what the world hides behind. Just like I saw when Alex Jones was on CNN. Of course he was carrying on foolishness when he was yelling at that old guy, Pierce Morgan, about the Second Amendment. But I saw it when I was in Manila. I saw it on television. But the point was that the producer was a woman, and she cried. She cried because Alex Jones yelled at Pierce Morgan. God bless you guys.